Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you and welcome to the Hampton Board of Selectmen's meeting for October 31st. First thing is public comment period. Is there anybody that would like to speak? Seeing none, we will go to announcements and community calendar.
Nothing, Mr. Chairman.
Just there's an hour left, probably a trick-or-treating, so anybody who's out there driving a car and stuff, please be careful and watch out for the children, because there's a lot of them out there trick-or-treating.
Yeah.
Also, I believe Mr. Bean can correct me if I'm wrong, that tomorrow morning at 7:30 at the Old Salt, there's a debate or an introduction of those running for state offices. So anybody who's interested in going to the Old Salt tomorrow at 7:30 in the morning, they can hear both sides of the argument.
Mr. Bean.
Thank you. No comments. And Mr. Waddell, Selectman Waddell, is correct on that time and that grid coordinate. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Rick.
I'd like to let everyone know that they're having another one of the meetings that they've been having down at the beach next, it's next Monday night at 5 o'clock, between 5 and 6:30. And they can talk or discuss different issues that have to do with the beach. And it's in the room upstairs and behind the stage.
Very good. Consent agenda. We have the Winnicott Extended Learning Opportunities, the ELO program for the fire department. That's all on the consent agenda.
I move these consent agenda.
Second.
All in favor? Unanimous. The approval of the minutes for October 17th.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor? Unanimous. First one, we have Mrs. McGrail, 27 Moulton Road. Put it to the mic or sit at the chair, either one.
Okay. My name is Claire McGrail, and I've lived at 27 Moulton Road since 1975. And during the summer, we've all noticed on the road that the traffic has gotten extremely fast, and it's going faster. And in 2014, August, one of our little neighbors was hit by a car on Moulton Road, and I have a testimony from his mother here, and I have copies for everybody, if I might get the copies.
Sure.
Okay.
I have five copies. Chair.
Would you like me to read it, or?
If you'd like, so the public can hear it, that's fine.
To whom it may concern.
Sir.
As a resident of 39 Moulton Road, I write in strong support of speed bumps being installed on our street. My husband and I have lived on Moulton Road since 2005. When we moved here, it seemed to be a family-friendly neighborhood, and we looked forward to raising our kids on this street. However, despite efforts on the part of Hampton's Police Department to curtail this, the speed at which people drive down our road has made me regret our decision to purchase a home here. I am constantly nervous when our kids, ages 5, 8, and 9, are playing in the front yard or crossing the street to visit friends or use the sidewalk. At dusk on August, in August 2014, our 3-year-old was waiting on the opposite side of our house with a neighbor who was helping him cross the road. When I called his older brother's home, he instead sprinted to me before our neighbor or I could stop him. I watched helplessly as he sprinted towards me, while headlights sped at him straight on. I'll never forget the quick prayer I said, while also knowing that our lives were about to change forever. Fortunately, the driver, although going too fast, was paying attention and screeched on her brakes to avoid literally running him over. Instead, Wes bounced off her front bumper and flew into our yard, escaping with bumps and bruises, but no serious injuries. Not a day goes by that I don't thank God that my 3-year-old wasn't crossing when a different driver was on our road, one of the countless other drivers who fly down our road daily as though they're cruising the autobahn, completely ignoring the slow children signs in our neighborhood, children themselves while often staring at their phones. It's maddening and, quite frankly, disturbing. To keep our kids safe, action must be taken. Speed bumps would ensure that drivers who use Moulton Road as a cut-through slow down in consideration of the children who live on our street, as well as those who use Moulton Road sidewalks to get through to and from Hampton schools. Thank you for your consideration. Megan Granger, 39 Moulton Road.
Okay. So what you're doing is you're looking for speed. Now, it also said Winnicunnet Road, too.
Well, I spoke to the police officer about that, and he said that's really not a good road for a speed bump. However, I have tried to cross that road, and it's almost impossible to cross because people are not slowing down for or stopping for the crosswalk, so it's hazardous, even though there's a blinking light there.
It is always a tough intersection.
Yeah.
Any questions from the board?
I don't have any questions.
You know, it's another one of those things, I think, that the GPS is... Because GPS, I know when I leave, where I live down,
there?
High Street, and I'm going to go to, it says turn on Moulton Road.
Yeah.
You know, so the darn GPS is sending people on cut-throughs that are not cut-throughs.
Right.
Which is one of the major problems. And I agree 100%, people drive way too fast, because I'm always have people behind me making gestures at me on High Street when I'm doing 30 miles
right.
an hour.
Right, exactly.
So I don't know, you know, it's a...
Phil?
No comments, thank you.
Rick? The only thing I could suggest is that, have you brought this up with the police chief in the past?
I
know what he's been doing is a number of, when we get complaints about different neighborhoods, he's been having neighborhood meetings to find out what the concerns and are from that. And so my suggestion would be first to contact him and see if he wants to look that up and address it, which I'm sure he will. I know one of the things he's been looking at is some of these signs that give you the radar, the more ones they can put up in different places.
Right.
And I guess you're getting his card right now. So.
Oh, okay, thank you.
How's that for service?
So would that be a traffic study that he would do? Or
well, he does a number of things.
Mr. Chairman, I'm going to address some of these issues in my quarter report, so if you want to hang around for that or you can watch it later, I'm going to probably touch on a part of these because we're experiencing this in a lot of neighborhoods.
I know you've done a couple of them already, and they seem pretty successful, where people come in with their concerns, and they address the concerns, and they start working on them. So you can either... go home and listen to it, or he's going to be bringing it up shortly. And
I'll just wait. But,
and then, like I said, get in contact with him, and then that's usually the first step.
Okay, would that be a means to an end to get the speed bumps?
Because that's where they've come from in the past.
I see.
When people have had them, that's you got to start. If everybody came here, we started doing it, we'd have everybody coming here. So we're trying to get him to find out what the actual needs and wants.
Okay.
And it may not, there may be a better thing than speed bumps.
Okay.
We don't know, maybe more enforcement, I don't know, but
yeah.
He would be the one to come up with that, not us.
Okay, there was a policeman there for a day or two, but then we didn't see one again, so.
And there's not a history of people getting speed bumps, to put it to you bluntly.
Right.
That just doesn't happen. Mm-hmm. It doesn't happen in the wintertime at all.
Yeah, because they take them out.
And it's not, it's just something that doesn't usually happen.
Okay, but are those flashing signs?
So it's
going
to be pretty
signs?
Hard to put it on your street, but we wouldn't put it on anyone else's.
But what it does do is you brought it up and it's brought it to the attention.
Okay.
So it, even by just doing that, there may be some more attention given to that street.
Okay.
So we've done a number of things in the past. We've changed some speed limits on different streets as a result of some of these meetings. There's been more enforcement on some of those. So your first step was come and bring it to our attention.
Okay.
And then we're going to suggest that you bring it to him and let him talk about it and discuss it with you or the group or however it happens, and we go from there.
Because
okay.
You have probably heard some discussion of people talking about the speed bumps, but there's not a long history of that happening here. So it would be unique.
Okay.
Thank you, Glenn.
Is it possible... There was someone that was coming to talk here at community announcements, and it just happened to walk in. I think you'd like to. Tom Sherman.
We can do that. We had, before you come up, We had a gentleman come in that wanted to speak at the public comment, and so if you'd like to come up, Tom. Rick Griffin realized that you would come in, and you were a couple of minutes late. And so
yeah, I'm really fine. Sorry. I'm on call on Monday night, so I was at the hospital. And
that's fine.
Just came straight over. I hope I wasn't too late. But
nope.
All I want to do is introduce myself. My name's Tom Sherman. I'm running for state senate. I'm currently state rep in Ryan, Newcastle. And I've talked to a lot of people. I wanted to know if there were any specific concerns that might be helpful for me to know about for the state level.
Well, usually on our public comment, that's just what it is. You come in and make a comment. I can tell you that, and I'll sure I'll speak for most of this board, is that we've had great representation with Nancy Stiles for Hampton, and we hope that continues.
I'd like to do that, and I've done the exact same thing. Nancy and I have worked together on several different issues in Ryan, Newcastle, including roads, drainage, beach, very similar issues. So I hope I can help you out as well.
Very good.
Thank you very much. Thanks for the time. Oh.
We'll say that he has I've met with him about some issues that we have here in Hampton, and he's pretty well versed on what happens here in Hampton.
Right. And I've met with Nancy several times, so I think it would be fairly seamless.
Very good.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Nice to meet you all.
You too.
Thank you.
Next, we have the police department with a departmental update. Morning, Chief and Deputy.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'll open by apologizing for not having your package to you earlier. We did have a somewhat busy week last week, I'm sure you've heard. So I have to wait my getting that to you. I like to get those to you a few days ahead of time so you have time to review them, but that just wasn't possible. All right, I'm going to start with this is the quarterly review. This is the time period, July 1st to September 30th, but I know more than likely we're going to delve into some other topics that have recently occurred, including the issues the lady prior to me was speaking about with the speed and the quality of life issues. So, general overview, our full-time staffing remains at 34. We do still have currently one officer out of service due to a duty-related injury. I believe that is going to come to a resolution here very shortly. Unfortunately, the officer involved is most likely going to have to retire due to medical conditions that it just will prevent him from coming back. So we're still waiting to hear from that, but the initial stages with retirement and finance have started to take place, so I believe that's going to probably happen sometime around the beginning of the new year. On Labor Day, September 5th, we concluded our summer season. Officer Jackson, Officer Kenyon, and Officer Sorokins served as corporals throughout the summer. Corporals serve as direct supervisors for our part-time special officers during our busiest times at the beach. Years past, the department utilized two corporals, but this year, with the increasing levels of visitors to the beach, decreasing levels of experience with our part-time special officer ranks, and the utilization of officers from area departments, an increase in supervision was necessary. Our current staffing level for part-time officers is at 33. We began the season with 31 working part-time officers and two were on leaves of absence. This number remained fairly consistent throughout the summer. We are hearing, though, our normal processes. We start hearing about some of our officers are being recruited by other agencies like Manchester State Police, Nashua, Salem. That's occurring now. There's three or four of them that I understand are in processes for other agencies, so we have the potential to start losing some folks early. The Hampton PD has four new officer recruits attending the 272nd New Hampshire Part-Time Academy scheduled to graduate on November 18th. As you recall, we ran a test back in April, so these are the folks that went to the academy from that testing process. On October 1st, another part-time officer test was conducted, which netted an additional five new officer recruits tentatively scheduled to attend the 273rd New Hampshire Part-Time Academy beginning in January of 2017. So that would give us a net of nine new officers if they all survived the training and the background process and all that. So we're potentially looking at nine new officers coming on. history being what it is, we generally lose a few before the summer starts, though either to other agencies or other issues come up as part of the hiring process. As you can see, our activities, this is a reflection of the same period last year, July 1st to September 30th. We are up in every one of the reported categories. Calls for service are up 21%. Motor vehicle stops, kind of what we're hearing are all around town with the driving issues we're facing, are up 48% in that time period. Arrests are up 32%. DWI arrests are up 28%. Drug offenses are up only 5%. Incidents reported up 3%. Offenses, 34%. Felonies, 46%. Parking tickets, 84%. And accidents are up 10%. I don't know if you want to wait to the end or if we want to talk about statistics right now, or we can move on to activity and then come back
to it. No, just come back to it.
Okay. Department recently concluded a busy summer season. Going into this season, we had a number of challenges we faced with, including staffing levels, the ongoing opioid crisis, and the level of contacts that the department was experiencing of intoxicated individuals. To offset our low staffing levels, we continued the program of augmenting with officers from area police departments throughout the remainder of the summer. Recruitment for law enforcement remains a critical issue nationally. I intend to continue the use of officers from other departments as public safety needs dictate, particularly in the preseason when we experience hot, busy days and schools across the region have skip days and their students descend upon Hampton Beach. Special thanks to the New Hampshire State Police, Rockingham County Sheriff's Department, University of New Hampshire Police Department, Epping Police Department, Exeter Police Department, and the Green Police Department, who all provided personnel and equipment to assist this summer. During the third quarter, we had one overdose death. Unfortunately, going into the fourth quarter, I'll touch upon it simply because we've seen a lot of it. We had five overdose deaths with a total of 9 for the year compared to 7 all of last year. Okay, so our numbers are already exceeding. Our detectives are working diligently trying to trace back the source of opioids coming into the community. This effort requires a regional approach, and we are consistently working with our federal, state, and local partners. The department continues to have an assignment with the DEA Diversion Task Force. The department continues to address the problem of intoxication and overservice of alcohol by coordinating with the New Hampshire Bureau of Liquor Enforcement. Hospitality meetings with those in the service industry have been co-hosted with the New Hampshire Liquor Enforcement Bureau, and along with compliance checks resulting in a number of establishments being cited. Department also provided office space to the investigator assigned to this area. We concluded our summer season on Labor Day, but immediately jumped into our event season with the Seafood Festival. Due to incidents across the globe, enhanced security measures were instituted. I'd like to thank the New Hampshire National Guard 10th Civil Support Team, New Hampshire State Police Bomb Squad, New Hampshire Homeland Security Emergency Management, Sea Coast Emergency Response Team, and the Sea Coast Chief Fire Officer Association for providing personnel and/or equipment that ensure a safe event. Other events included Reach the Beach, Granite State Wheelman, and the Smutty Nose Rockfest Half Marathon. While all of our events drew large crowds, traffic and security issues were managed well due to the level of cooperation and coordination between both public and private partners. Events and good weather continued throughout the month of September, requiring additional staffing as needed. Each of the events that needed officers for traffic and security was required to hire officers on private detail at no cost to the taxpayer. On September 16th, Deputy Chief Hobbs graduated the 265th session of the FBI National Academy. The FBINA is a 10-week program which provides coursework in intelligence theory, terrorism, terrorist mindsets, management science, law, behavioral science, law enforcement communication, and forensic science services to improve the administration of justice in police departments and agencies at home and abroad to raise law enforcement standards, knowledge, and cooperation worldwide. With the end of the summer season, the department has been full swing with our training schedule. This training includes our own use of force and firearms training, but also our continued participation in the FBI Law Enforcement Executive Development Association. 3 members of the department, Officer Karpenko, Jackson, and Kenyon, received the prestigious FBI Leader Trilogy Award for completing all 3 courses for the leadership series. And with that, I'll entertain any questions from the board.
Any questions for the Chief or Deputy?
Congratulations, Deputy Chief Hobbs.
Thank you.
Getting back from the FBI Academy. And congratulations to the 3 officers who received the award. But most of all, I want to just thank Hampton Police Department, especially getting us through Seafood Festival season the whole summer with no real occurrences, because it's pretty scary what's going on nationally right now. And I think the police presence that we have in town is tremendous.
Thank you.
And thank you very much.
Thank you. Jim?
Yeah, I'd like to ditto that, and congratulations on the graduation from the FBI. And nice to have young guys doing that. And congratulations on a successful summer, and you guys do a great job. And I know you've had some really tough weeks the last few weeks, and you know, thank God nobody's been injured or anything on the police force. And
fortunate.
You've done a great job. All these things being up, like arrests up 32%, motor vehicle stops 48%, DWIs 28%. I mean, that's really discouraging.
It is and it isn't. I try to look at what is it really. I mean, you know, there's an old saying: you got truth, lies, and statistics. Okay, and statistics can tell you different things, and I think you really have to look at what they mean in the town of Hampton. We have to recognize something. With the improvements we've made in the community, there's more people coming here. Okay, there's just more, there's a greater volume when you go down there on a Saturday or Sunday afternoon, and you see the volume of people that are down there. And then at night, with the improvements that we're seeing with our entertainment venues, there's more people. So there's some good to that economically, but we do have to deal with those other issues, the increases that you're seeing. The other thing I'll attribute it to is a very dedicated group of professionals out there working, and just say, I look at motor vehicle stops, really tells me where we're at, because that is pure proactive police work. Okay, you're not waiting for a report, you're not sitting around waiting for the next thing to happen. In the absence of something going on, you're going out to find and to prevent. And in my history in this town, I've been here since 1979 and law enforcement 27 years, the best thing we can do with a community is to be very visible. And they were very visible. And I think they made a difference. There's no more letting the little things go by waiting for the big things at Hampton PD. We address everything we can, and we try to keep them, address the little issues so the big issues don't happen. And I think that's truly the mindset. And when we determined that we were going to add supervision, which was needed when we went to the third corporal, I think that's really played a part in it, because if you look at our staff right now, we have some very senior people, we have no middle class, and then we have very junior people. Okay, I have one officer left from the class of 2012. The next junior person is the class of 2003. So we have a significant gap in there. We have the haves and the have-nots as far as experience go. So you want these young people to go out and really do the job and get the experience, but the only way that can happen without causing significant liability and risk to the town is supervision. So we took that step, and I think it's really worked well for us. Those guys did a great job, the corporals. They worked probably the worst schedule in the department. They worked Tuesday through Saturdays and Sundays, mixing it up between days and evenings, and you know, some of them were sleeping overnight in the locker room, just so they could cover shifts for each other. So it was an incredible operation this summer. Very proud of them. But they did a lot of work, and it's just our hallmark. We train better than anybody in the state of New Hampshire. And I'm not putting anybody else down. Nobody trains like Hampton PD, but we have to because of what we have to police. Go from a nice little town of 15,000 to the biggest city in the state.
Right. So. Thank you. Do a great job.
Phil?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chairman. Deputy Chief Hobbs, congratulations on your graduation from the FBI Academy.
Thank you.
Very prestigious. Like the old man sitting next to you, you joined that club. Chief Sawyer, good evening.
I'm offended by that. But
great report. I'm much older than you are, young man. Just wait. And great summer. You hate to jinx the summer's operations and talk about it during the summer, but it was a tremendous performance of duty, like all of the departments, so thank you for that. This week, and you'll brief perhaps some of that later, again, your job is a very complex job. It's becoming increasingly more so nationwide. Nobody is immune or ignorant of what's going on with respect to law enforcement. The department that you two gentlemen lead is one of the finest departments in the country, and we're very, very proud of you. Your report, the third quarter report, is very interesting. Thank you for the information. Do you want to discuss the state?
Sure. I added that back piece several years ago. There was significant interest in what our activity was on state property. So in our computer system, we have what's called sites. If you own a business, you have a site so that if we respond there, we just punch in the site and it automatically registers part of the log. So we developed sites for all the different areas in the state or state properties that we respond to try to get a, you know, an idea of how much time we're spending policing in the state property. So that's what this is a reflection of. I do have a more broken down by each of these sites what the calls for service were. I didn't think you wanted that tonight because it's very in-depth. I can certainly share that document with anybody that wants it. Just email me and I'll send that to you. But it gives you a little insight as to what areas that we're spending a lot of time on. You'll look at things like the tolls. We don't spend a lot of time out in the tolls or the liquor stores because the New Hampshire State Police patrols those regularly. We have concurrent jurisdiction out there, and quite frankly, we're so busy that they're fine handling that. The only time we're really out there at, say, the liquor store is when the ambulance rolls. When an ambulance rolls anywhere in the town of Hampton, a cruiser is supposed to go with it, whether the state police is responding or not. We're there to protect the assets of the town and the risk of the town employees as opposed to what they might be doing out on the highway. But then as you look at the posts, you can see the significant increase. State Main Beach area, you have 56 calls in that period. And then State Main Beach behind the seashell, 20 calls. We really narrowed it down to look at where we were going and what we were engaged in. Most of it is the disorderly conduct and the alcohol violations, to be very honest, without even looking at that broken down set. That's mainly what we're dealing with. We did deal with a number of complaints from folks wanting to know why the state isn't, you know, got cameras or enhanced security and all that. And, you know, we explained to them that, you know, we work well with the state entity, but that is under their control, and what happens there is under their direction. I did have a good meeting with Phil Bryce, who came down just prior to the Seafood Festival, concerned about that was that time period when we had a number of terrorist incidents that gained a lot of coverage, including the incident over in Nice, and what steps we were taking and what could they do to help. So we've had good discussions about what we were doing this year and where we'd like to go with it. I don't want to get into too many specifics on it. It deals with security measures. But I found him very open to my suggestions on what the state should be doing on their property and how to enhance security with physical measures, but also with law enforcement. We're actually considering, they have a small contingent of law enforcement that are park rangers, that are sworn law enforcement, that with my permission, they'd have to seek for them to come down and work with us, to be just another set of eyes out there, particularly down at the south end of the beach, where we don't get a lot of calls down there, but we're starting to see an increased presence of issues with drugs and alcohol, that if there was a uniform presence there, obviously if there's anything of serious consequence, that they would call us to handle it, but there would be just another set of eyes that the state was paying for. I inquired as to them paying for officers from Hampton to perform that function. That's a difficult thing for them to do because of their administrative rules and their budgets, so I don't think that's going to be anything we're going to explore, but I believe the communication is open. It's just what can we each do based on budgets and process. So,
yeah, thank you. And I found the data extremely informative. Just for the quarter, for example, your arrests, 21% of arrests for your department are on state property. So nearly one in five during the quarter, if I'm reading it right. 131 arrests out of your total arrests for the quarter. One in four, we are taxing our citizens and taxing our police department that is having hard times recruiting people, as all platforms are, private sector and public sector. It's hard to get people to work today. Mm-hmm. It challenges our town. This has been an ongoing debate. Mr. Sherman was in here earlier. He's running for state senate. There's an election on Tuesday. And these are the kind of metrics that will be valuable when we take the discussion post this election next week, and engage in a different kind of discussion in Concord. And both your data and other departments' data under Mr. Welch's leadership and Chairman Bridles will be instructive in proving that case. And why is the Hampton taxpayer spending 21% of the budget, because ultimately you protect lives and protect property and arrest people that violate law, And we're spending 21% of our effort on state property, and we're unreimbursed by it. So it's an interesting debate, and it's one that will only be augmented and proved to be successful by this type of site data. And if we move to develop that type of specific data from our other department heads as well, so that's a very cogent and very informed argument. So thank you for it. Thank you for your leadership. Thank you for the briefing. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Rick.
Yes. Now, could you mention again about the park rangers? Have we ever had them here before?
Actually, we have. It's a rare occasion, but several years ago, I remember we had a late season storm that was causing quite a swell, and that the governor, I remember being on the phone with the governor and Jimmy Donahue, and we were all up at the old lifeguard station, and the discussion was about closing the beach because it wasn't safe. So how were we going to manage that? Because they were already down to their skeleton crew, and I only had so many people that we could offer to it. And they did send a couple of the park rangers down to assist in keeping people off the beach. So it's not unprecedented. It's just one of those things when we have law enforcement activities that are going to take place in the town of Hampton, I think we have to be in the know of how that's going to happen and coordinate that, because you don't want agencies working against each other. That's why we have such a close relationship with the New Hampshire State Police and the Rockingham County Sheriff's Department. We let each other know what we're doing operationally, so we're not wasting efforts on something somebody else is already working on, and you don't wind up, you know, crossing in the middle somewhere where you didn't need to. So it's just one of those things where, under New Hampshire law, I do have the control as chief of police of the law enforcement mission. And I'm open to bringing other assets. I think we've demonstrated that. I just want to know what they're going to be doing, what their role is going to be, and that they understand, if they need our assistance, how that works.
So they have the ability to coordinate with you?
Yes.
Yeah. And, you know, I think that's really good. And I've made a point of trying to meet with as many people that are running for office to tell them about the issues that we have here in Hampton. And I've been pushing Phil's agenda with every one of them. And I think they all, pretty much all of them, seem to be aware of it. Yeah. And I think it's a good thing. And I think that this park, you know, I was recently up in the mountains. I saw park people all over the place there, rangers. I saw a couple of them at least. And I don't understand why they wouldn't have them here too.
Well, it depends. Are they the law enforcement contingent or not? Because I'm going to have them down at the beach and they're going to be acting in law enforcement capacity, I want them to be certified, capable of making an arrest, and armed.
Well, it sounds to me, by looking at this, these locations that you mentioned, it would be something totally appropriate for someone that was a park ranger to go behind the seashell, or in the bathrooms, or maybe just, you know, being helpful to the people in some way. So, particularly in the future, with some of the big changes that are coming forward, you know, when they get ready to redo the roads and stuff like that, the way we're going to be doing some crossing, you know, the crossings will be different, hopefully, at some point, whether it's 4 years or 8 years down the road or whatever. And maybe that's the type of thing that we'll need some people like that that could help facilitate all these new changes. So I think it's a good idea. And congratulations, Deputy Chief Hobbs, for it seemed to work very well for Mr.
Yeah, he gets a 10-week sabbatical in the summer while I'm dealing with the beach. Yeah, that was great. That was a good deal.
Well, yes, I bet you're on the same wavelength quite often because of your experience. And I think that it's wonderful to see how close you work with other police departments this week. From what I hear, the people from Seabrook over there did a great job coming over here, too.
Yep.
From what I've heard.
I think one of the things we've all come to realize with the challenges we face today, you have to play well in the sandbox. You can't be, you know, we're Hampton, so we don't talk to the state police, or we don't talk. We just can't have that. It doesn't work that way, and you see what occurred the other night, that the response that we received from the Seacoast Emergency Response Team is essential for public safety these days. It's not a luxury anymore. I know some people think, you know, oh, you got tanks and all that, and that's just not the case. These are absolute needs for us to provide protection to our officers who are providing safety to the community. So the only way you can do that these days is being willing to share assets and work with other people. It's just the only way it's going to happen.
Yeah, and maybe if we ask for these this help with like these park rangers or whatever, we'll other people that are in the legislature that aren't running for office here will get to know what we're facing here in Hampton. Yeah.
Understand with the rangers, that's going to be a minimal thing because there's not many of them. To mm-hmm. be honest with you, the folks you saw aren't the folks I'm talking about. They're very minimal, but it's one of those things that Mr. Bryce seeing, obviously, I think the video we all saw at the beginning of the summer was a scary video of one of our officers being surrounded, and they was on state property, and they're cognizant of that, and they were very worried about that. What can we do to help? So I think the intent is to try to help. What level they can provide, that's going to be a different discussion, but whatever I can get, I'll get.
Well, good. Thank you very much for your report.
Thank you.
I know he called it a sabbatical, but I'm sure there wasn't a person happier to be home than your wife and family. But congratulations on you.
Thank you.
You know, he took that sabbatical, too. He just didn't plan his as good when he did his.
I did it in the fall football season.
But I was down the beach a lot this year, and it was good to see our other communities, surrounding communities that came in to help, that you brought in, and they're all very professional.
Yeah. I know that's raised, you know, it's a different way of doing it, and I understand that. I've heard some mostly positive comments. I've heard some people, I don't think I've heard anybody really be negative about it, just concerned about, we've never done this before, which isn't really the case, because if you can go back and Mr. Holman, who was a great historian, he's got a lot of old pictures from our history of Hampton PD, and you can all, early 1800s, we had them in from Keene, from Nashua, and there's some great pictures of those officers back in the day helping patrol Hampton Beach. We're just in a different point in history where recruitment is what it is. It's one of those issues that I'd love to tell you that I'm going to hire 9 this year, and I'm only going to lose 2. The reality is we'll probably be in the 5 to 7 range that we hire, and there's a possibility we'll lose more than that. We could go into a negative number this year. That potential exists.
Well, the nice thing is we can get them here. Yep. It gives us good qualified people that are in town. Yep. It also gives them the opportunity to maybe see some stuff they might not see in their own communities.
Yep.
And their ability, it helps their officers also.
And just all the departments that we've engaged in this program, the University of New Hampshire, obviously we've been doing this for a couple of years. They are very similar in operations. They do deal with a lot of people that are young, partying, and had a little too much to drink and other substances. And you have to know how to deal with that when you're in a crowded situation or you become gasoline on the fire. I think Officer Masakis' response that day when he got surrounded was very cool, calm, and collected. He could have caused a greater problem if he hadn't kept his demeanor. And those are the types of people and the agencies we try to bring in. All of our other agencies are members of the Seacoast Emergency Response Team. We train with them. We work with them in other stress environments. So we have a lot of faith in what those chiefs provide. And bringing them in, I think, has been a great asset to our mission. So we'll continue the program as long as we need to.
Well, knock on wood, I think you had a great summer season. Great. You know, Seafood Festival, that went over well. I know you brought in a lot of people for other avenues, and that worked out well, too. So, okay. I know we have your budget.
One other issue, this is kind of an issue that would be part of we have a grant that we're going to look at the end, but I just want to highlight to the board, I will be coming back in the near future on 2 grants that we're working on that are cooperative grants with other agencies. One of them is... We're working on a grant with the University of New Hampshire Police Department, Waconia, and Durham Police Departments for an item called a Skywatch Tower. If you've ever traveled down to New York City in Times Square, they have several of them. They're a hydraulic tower that an officer can be in it or not, and there's a number of other items in there with radios and cameras for surveillance that we'll be utilizing. You know, when we research the grant, the different events that each of these communities hosts, the calendar just fell really well for us because Waconia has Bike Week. They'll have it up there then. We have the 4th of July, Seafood Fest, and our bigger events. UNH will have homecoming, commencement, those type of things, and Durham along with them. So it would seem like a natural fit, and we threw everything in it we could think of. And they said yes. $140,000 worth of equipment that we will get without any match. We just have to be able to train our folks up on how to use it. I had the was fortunate. I was out in San Diego for the Chiefs conference, and the guy that was actually building our unit was the gentleman on the floor. So I got a firsthand demonstration in the convention center, and it I think it's going to be a great asset to our security features down there for the events. So the second one is a Department of Safety Opiate Abuse Reduction Initiative. It's Portsmouth, Greenwood, and Hampton, an amount of $59,000. This is going to be a saturation patrol issue where we're going to be trying to go into these areas where we've clearly identified where the drug markets are between the three communities. The reason these three communities have come together is, again, when you come in collaborative efforts, you have a better chance of getting what you're looking for. And it's the Route 95 corridor, which has, you know, been clearly identified as a drug corridor in New Hampshire. So these three towns have put together a program where we'll be going out, assigning officers on given times, working between the three communities, and trying to hit those areas where we know the drugs are being distributed. So
excellent.
That'll be coming down probably within the next month.
While she's here, do you want to talk a little bit about your community meetings that you've held?
Sure.
I think that's a good time to bring it up.
As you recall, we've been having some difficulties with what we refer to as quality of life issues. It's out on Mary Batchelder Road in that area of the Triangle. It's the trucks and speed and a lot of other associated issues. And that's what we discovered when we had the first meeting, was it was more than one issue. So I think we had roughly 35, almost 40 people for that meeting. And I thought the participation was well. I thought, they offered some criticisms, and it was done constructively. It's my only thing. I know sometimes people get upset with us. They don't think we're there, and I try to explain how we operate. And I think everybody understood it, and we did get a lot of thanks for the efforts we've been making. We do get there's one neighbor out there that keeps a running log for us. And she submits that to us on a weekly basis of what she's seeing, and it's showing a reduction based on our efforts. We are also taking further steps. I'm working together with the New Hampshire State Police Troop G, which Troop G is the DOT guys, the guys with the scales that work on all the truck and the commercial carriers, to have them come in on selected dates and set up in that area to also further enhance the enforcement for trucking violations. It's kind of like liquor enforcement. We do what we do, and sometimes it works, but when entities that can take your license and your ability to drive the truck, as opposed to just giving you a ticket for driving on our road, people that can actually take your license away for violations, it tends to go circles around quick. The news gets there that the state police, the DOT folks are out there, and again, those are much larger fines than what we write for town ordinances. We write a $100 fine, $200 fine. These folks generally start in the area of $500. So we're going to try to utilize them to try to help get the message out to the folks that are committing the violations. So, again, we've discussed there are a couple of issues. We need to work on the ordinance on that, though. I'll be coming forward to you hopefully in the next month or two with some suggestions on language changes to the current ordinance on the through trucking. Tide Mill Road, similarly, it's a trucking issue, but the establishments that are being delivered to are on Tide Mill Road. We did have a representative from one of the businesses, Brazonics, which I think helped put a face to it. And another good discussion about what is actually a violation and what is not. Mm-hmm. We took some initial steps where we have a variable message board out there at Landing Road advising commercial carriers, deliveries, to utilize Hardart's Way to make those deliveries. And the folks I've talked to out there are also experiencing an improved situation. Again, I don't try to fool anybody and tell you I'm going to solve the problem and I'm going to end it. The best we're going to do is mitigate it and make it tolerable for you. But the only way we can do that is if you reach out to us and let us know. So surely on Moulton Road or any other, offer any other neighborhood that's experiencing these problems, if you'd like to have a neighborhood meeting, please reach out to us. We'll have you down for a cup of coffee at the training room, and we'll try to figure out a way, because there's usually more than one problem. That's one thing we are finding out. There's usually more than one problem in a neighborhood. It may start with traffic issues, but it may wind up being something where we kind of find out there's a house that's selling drugs. That's the only, you know, truly, if we don't have citizens that are willing to let us know what's going on in their neighborhoods, we drive through, we try to be where we can. But, you know, as I try to explain to some people, you know, what times are your busy times? And when they explained it, I go, that's what I thought, because those are the busy times throughout the town. When I only have 4 to 6 officers working, whose neighborhood do I pick? You know, how do I work that? So we try to move people around and cover those areas. There is a warrant article moving forward from the police department for traffic calming devices, which include a number of the speed bumps and the portable pole-mounted radar units, which also have the ability to do traffic counts for us. So we'll try to put them up. And even if we don't have the radar on, it'll do a traffic count for us. So we can try to establish that baseline of where the trouble areas that we really not need to prioritize are. So I would ask folks, I would ask the board to support that warrant article when we go over them, and the voters also. I forget the total dollar number, Fred, do you recall?
Not off the top of my head, no.
But there was variable message boards involved in that, the speed bumps and the pole-mounted radar items. So I think those are well worth considering the issues we're experiencing throughout town and the complaints. Even with the dramatic increase in activity the officers are producing, we're still getting the complaints. So we got to find some other measures to try to alleviate those issues.
Okay. So I would assume she will get a hold of you and you'll take it from there.
If you don't hear from me, call and ask to speak to Linda. Linda will yell at me. You'll hear from me.
Okay. So now we're on the budget review.
Did you want to go line by line? How would you like to proceed with this, or if there are any significant questions that are jumping out?
Fred, do you have any?
No.
Okay. We will bring it to the board and see if there's any questions.
Well, just for, if you wouldn't mind, Mr. Chairman, for the public in here.
Yeah.
What we're requesting is a sum of $4,108,300, which goes to a 3.21% increase, I believe, over last year.
Okay. You want to start, Regina?
Yeah, I mean, I did have a question. Just one second. Is this a new line under support services, outside agencies?
Yes. That line, again, we initiated that program this year where we started paying officers to come in and work with us. And we had been using that initial out of what's called Fund 26, the overage in the detail account.
Okay.
But that is not a practice I want to engage in for a long period of time. It was something we needed to do in the immediate to get through the season with what we were experiencing. So we spent approximately $20,000 for a program that we didn't start until, I want to say, right around the beginning, end of June, beginning of July. So I did ask for an appropriation of $30,000 because my intent is to start that program earlier.
Right.
As soon as the weather breaks and we start getting the kids coming up out of Merrimack Valley and taking over the beach, I intend on having this program up and running. So that's why I requested a $30,000 appropriation for that line.
Okay. Yeah, no, I would. So pretty much it's just we didn't have it appropriated properly last year.
We didn't have appropriated because that was not a program when I started last year, it wasn't anything I envisioned happening. But when circumstances got to the point that they did, with the shortages we were experiencing, the state police, if you recall, had a significant budget issue. And they're in the same problem we are, finding qualified people to take the job, that they just couldn't provide the level of service that we've experienced in the past. And no fault of theirs, they're in the same boat we are. They gave us everything they could.
Right.
It just wasn't enough. So I pushed a lot of people up on the night shifts for us, and I used these folks from out of town primarily on day shifts on the weekends when we were getting the huge crowds.
Right. Okay. Yep. All right. Thank you. I don't have anything else.
I noticed on that, in that same vein, you also have a reduction in your part-time special officers' wages. So that kind of offsets that a little.
Well, actually, no. Actually, the, okay. What happened was, is over the years, we've looked, and one of the things I noticed was we would always be underspent in the part-time officer wages, but we would be overspent in the full-time officers covering the part-time officers. So I shifted some of the numbers to reflect historically what I'm seeing. Just, I know some people look at, you know, me, I kind of look at the bottom line. Am I exceeding my bottom line? And I don't think we ever have.
Right.
But I know for transparency reasons, people want to know, why are we overspending here and not here? So I just, where I can, I'm trying to move money around to properly reflect where the money's being spent.
Very good.
So with that underspending in that account as opposed to overspending in that, I just shifted some of that money. That's really more than what that is.
Okay. Jim?
Yeah. I mean, you gave the bottom line figure $4,108,300, which seems like a large number. But when you think about it, and you think about the number of people that you're servicing and the number of people that we have in town in the summer, you really can't compare Hampton to any other town. So you look at a lot of other towns with our year-round population, and they're not far below us on their bottom line either. They're very close in the bottom line. So with what you're asking for, and I think it's important for people, for the public, when they look at the bottom line, to also, when the budget goes online, to look at it line by line so they can see where it's being spent and that it's being spent in appropriate areas.
Well, the other item I'd highlight, with a 3.21 increase, we've also experienced, as you recall, the voters passed warrant article last year to give the members of the Hampton Police Association, which covers both sergeants, full-time patrolmen, detectives, and part-time officers, with contractual raises that take effect April 1st, and there'll be another contractual raise due this April 1st. So you have as much as a 6% increase potentially in the 17 budget reflected, because obviously the first year of a contract that doesn't reflect in the budget, it's outside of the budget. Now it's in the budget, plus the 3% that's coming in April. So coming in at 3.21, even with those raises, I think we did a good job really looking at the budget and moving the numbers and making them really reflect what we're doing.
You did. A couple of things. That uniform pay went up 33%.
Which line, Joe?
23,
1900. For the administration, crime control?
Crime control.
Yeah. That was one thing. We didn't score that right. Well, it's contractual, because crime control is the detectives. As part of the collective bargaining agreement that was signed or approved last year, there was an increase in the detectives' uniform pay because of the fact that they have to wear civilian attire, suit and tie, to help them in that area, because they have to spend more. They have to maintain a uniform set, but they also have to maintain appropriate civilian attire required by policy. So that's why that increased to that
degree.
All
right. And I had another question on under traffic control and patrol. Traffic control and patrol.
Yeah.
Vehicle replacement. You had $82,000 in this year's budget, and you spent zero so far, and you have $82,000 next year.
If you saw the updated monthlies, the cars literally arrived today.
Okay.
They drove in today. I was downstairs in dispatch when the folks from Irwin Ford showed up with the three brand new cars. So we, at the suggestion of, I want to give credit where credit is due, Lieutenant Gidley, who maintains the fleet, asked if I would have a problem if we ordered the cars later in the year. And I says, well, what's the logic behind it? He says, well, it's two issues. One, we beat up cars during the summer because there's so many different drivers. And if you talk to anybody that's a fleet manager, the more people that drive a car, you know, you have a car with 100,000 miles. If you drive it, it's going to look a lot better than if 10 people drive a cruiser, just because of the different driving habits. So it saved the wear and tear on the car a little bit. But the other problem we had is when we traditionally get the cars, we would be changing out three cars, because when they come in, we have to change the gear out of the existing car, which is a cumbersome job. It takes about 2 days to transfer all the gear out of one car into the new car. So we would be doing that in the middle of the summer. So we'd be down two or three cars, which in the summertime is just really hinders the operation. So, you know, I said, that's a good idea. When would we order them? He goes, we'll make the order right after Seafood Fest. We'll make the order so we get them after Seafood Fest. And again, they literally rolled in today. So that was the logic behind that. So that's expended.
Super.
Almost all expended.
And support services, court wages going down 40%.
Yeah, I took a look. It's just one of those things with the court system being backed up that we're trying to work more cases out as negotiations as opposed to going to trial. And really trying, they actually have a system now where somebody shows up to court before their trial to try to work out a negotiation with my prosecutor. We're trying to minimize the time an officer is spending in court because it's time they're not on the street or it's overtime the town is paying for a lot of them very minor offenses. So if we can come to a negotiated plea on an open container of beer, a speeding ticket, a stop sign, so it's reflecting that we're spending less in that area. We're really trying to spend less in that area.
And vacation wages under support services went up 33%.
Yeah, that was just a move because in 15 you saw the actual was 17,517. And so I just tried to get a little bit closer to what the actual use was. When you look at sick time and vacation time, it's very hard to judge those, and it's getting harder simply because we're getting a lot more new faces into the workforce. And they have a different mindset as to how they use their time. They look at it differently than we do. And so I suspect those areas are probably going to increase progressively over the years. As more of the older guys retire who save their time, the people that come in the workforce use their time. Okay, that's just the nature of the workforce. That I think those numbers are going to slowly creep up. So I'm just trying to creep it up a little bit and keep up with it.
Okay. Thank you.
Bill?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you, gentlemen. Reviewed your budget. I'll go over a couple of salients. I like your budget. I think it appropriates taxpayer dollars to the exigencies and the primary thrust of your operations, and you're keeping lean those areas that you should keep lean. I just reviewed very quickly the budget, and Mr. Welch, great work working with your department heads in this budget process. And Mr. Bridle. Again, on your busy summer, your operational intensity, calls for service are up 21%, 8,600 and change. That's 4 per hour. That dwarfs most law enforcement agencies anywhere in the state by leaps and bounds. And again, that's up from 7,143 the year before. So you're averaging full another call for service per hour. Motor vehicle stops are up 48%. Arrests are up 32%. DWIs 28%. You know the drug issues that you folks deal with. Offenses up 34%. Felonies 46%. And of course, there's your community involvement, your community outreach, and then there's that parking issue. And again, 21% of this this effort is unreimbursed on state property. Having said that, you highlighted pay and your administration against those stark increases in that huge quantum productivity leap that your department has executed, and I commend you for that productivity surge. Administration, you touched on some well-deserved contractual pay increases and leadership increases that it would essentially be flat. It's at 4.27, but with inflation and your contractual obligations, that's essentially flat. Crime control and investigations against that substantial quantum leap in performance is up just 12%. So your response in the field is up some places near 50%, 21%, 84%, 46%. The meat of your budget and what you do and what we see is up just a quarter of that surge. So. For those that are actually looking at numbers, for those that actually have a business mind, for those that have some operational talent, that's a huge, huge taxpayer leverage, and we really appreciate it. Traffic and control, again, leveraging the taxpayer dollar is essentially flat. Your training, 1.27, again, a harsh environment for recruiting people, a lot of turnover, the millennial phenomena, and you keep that flat. You don't come in here and burden us with excuses. You get the job done. Again, I really like this budget. Police station and building, a lot gets done there. That's down 4%. Really like the budget. Really like what you guys do. Thank you for the hard work. I know as you rise in the ranks, this is what you always aspire to do. You have a saying for it. You've told me about it, but pushing the paper, you've done a good job. Thanks for the budget. Thanks, Mr. Chairman.
Rick?
Yeah, I took a look at the budget also at 3.21%. It seems reasonable to me. And I think everyone here made some good points. Thank you.
Appreciate it.
Now, how are we with gasoline?
Gasoline, we saved significant amounts by getting to, as you recall, we went to that the WEX card, yep. Which everybody falls suit after we did it. It's kind of funny talking to people on the gas prices and how to adjust that, because you're kind of locked in when you deal with the state of New Hampshire to a three-year pricing, which was above and beyond what, you know, after the taxes, if we were going to the pump right uptown, we could save big money. So we wound up doing that, and that's where a lot of the savings you're seeing in budgets that we just really cut because of the price. And then I went and looked at the actuals, what we were using in each of the lines we have for fuel, and really tried to cut it down to what we've been using and just trying to watch the fuel, because the cars we're getting, keep in mind in patrol, the SUVs are more fuel efficient than the old Crown Vicks, so we'll see a little bit of a savings there. I think our last Crown Victorias are going out the door this year. There's only two of them left, and they're admin cars anyhow. So everything is kind of in a better place as far as fuel efficiency, cost. So I think that's where we saved a significant amount of money.
I know it was a big point last year, and I going to the WEX card, I think, has definitely helped us out across the board. So other than that, your budget looks pretty good to me.
Yeah. I'd like to say one more thing. Yeah, I think it is, you know, not a large increase, but there has certainly been a large increase of people asking for help from the police department from many different, almost every which way there is.
I got to be honest, I try to look beyond the borders of Hampton PD. I try to look at, and I try to teach, particularly the supervisory staff, to take a look beyond what it is to us. How do we fit in to the budget of the town? What's our piece of the pie? And how, you know, because we have a responsibility, I think, to the taxpayers, but, you know, to the other entities in town to work well with them, because, you know, the school, you know, we have a big project going at the school, and do we need it? Yeah, I think we do. Eventually, we need to improve our schools. So I try not to come at the taxpayers with a lot of wants. I try to really limit it to needs. So one of the issues we did last year is we had the monitor truck up on a warrant article, $40,000. I was going to move forward with that again this year. The problem I was afraid of is if that warrant article were to go down, that means we can't replace the truck if it goes down. And we almost lost it last year. The fuel tank started rusting. Remember, I came in with some pictures of the frame and all that. There's no way, in my opinion, that truck would survive another season. So what do? Come back at the taxpayer for $40,000 on a warrant article? I didn't want to do that. I wanted to limit my warrant articles. I know that's another bone of contention with the voters, that it's just the ballot's too long. So I'm trying to do my part to limit it. So talking around with the monitor guys, they came up with an idea. The vehicle I drive is a Tahoe, which is large enough to pull our trailer. I'm going to take that and put that into service with the Mounted Patrol, and I'm going to get a smaller vehicle, because I don't need that large of a vehicle. I just don't. With the things I'm doing, a smaller vehicle the size of the deputies, the Ford, is what I'm going to go with, which is substantially less costly to the taxpayer, and I'm going to try to do that within the surplus of this year's budget, as opposed to adding a $40,000 item to next year's budget or into the warrant article. So we're trying to look at those ways to try to come at the budget. Where could we save? What are we not seeing? One of the things I did consider, and I didn't do it, was I think our activity rates warrant more personnel. The problem we have is, traditionally, the way in Hampton we've done it, we utilize part-time personnel more than any other department in the state of New Hampshire. But we're again, the recruiting issues we're experiencing are just significant. It's hard to get ahead. We're not getting ahead. We keep falling behind every year because 9 come in 12 leave. So we're playing that battle all the time. I think we're at that issue, that time where we're going to have to consider adding full-time personnel. I didn't add it into the budget, but talking to the manager, I'm considering putting together a warrant article for 2 full-time positions and let the taxpayers take a whack at it. I don't normally like that, but I think we're in a time and an era where I think everybody can see that we're pretty stretched thin, and our ability to address every issue in town, and I hate having to look at taxpayers and say, I appreciate your issue, but it's not as important as this issue. I don't like being put in that position, but I might find myself at these meetings having to tell people that. I appreciate speeding cars down your road with little kids is a problem for you, but I'm at what I'm at. Should I pull one of the SROs out of the school? Should I pull my detective off the task force that's working on the opioids? I'm kind of at saturation right now, and the only solution I see, other than those short-term fixes that we've initiated with the outside agencies coming in the summer operation, but my October has been worse than my August with everything we've been dealing with. I need some full-time personnel, so I was considering drafting a warrant article requesting funding for 2 positions, but I wanted to have that discussion with the members of the board because I'm not going to waste my time doing that if I don't feel the board would support it.
Well, I think you've got some good ideas there. I think driving around in a smaller car is a good sacrifice. I'm sure you would look good in a nice black Escalade. But so I think people will notice.
No, I appreciate it. When I started the process, I made my mind up that I was going to go really line by line and cut everything I could out because I knew I was going to have to add things like the $30,000 to try to bring in the outside. The other attempt we're making to do is there are certain functions within the police department that don't have to be a sworn member of the department. Now, I saw, with interest how the process went last year when the fire department tried to go with a full-time secretary's position, which, I talk to the chief all the time. I think he could have used the help. But the voters spoke, and we have to respect that. So I tried to come at that part of it with a different perspective of maybe I can add a part-time position that would alleviate somebody that's doing a task that doesn't need to be a full-time officer. So I'm looking at a part-time position as an evidence tech. The city of Portsmouth does it, number of agencies where this is a person that, you come in on a Monday, all the evidence from the weekend's activities are in the lockers, you catalog them, we have to, keep a very tight chronology of where that evidence has been, where it's going, driving up to the lab if we have drugs that have to be analyzed. That doesn't have to be a sworn member of the police. It doesn't have to be a police officer. That can be a civilian. So within the budget, we added some money. So for the potential, if the budget passes, that I could add a part-time civilian position to help in the evidence room, releasing a detective who does that work to go out and do investigations on opioids and other issues that are occurring in town that we desperately need. So I'm trying to do it other ways that I can, but I think we're at that point we have to consider adding full-time personnel.
Thank you.
If not this year, maybe next.
Thank you very much.
Tim?
Just make a quick statement on savings on the gas and stuff. I think we have a member of the budget committee in the audience, and I think it was the budget committee that really pushed that a couple of years ago. So I think kudos to the budget committee for bringing that up and pushing that issue.
Well, you obviously have had a very stressful October with everything that's gone on, and I'll commend your department and the men in your department and the women for a tough month. Hopefully November's a little bit better.
Well, if I could share with the board, obviously we know we had a significant incident occur down at the beach Thursday evening. I got the call from the deputy letting me know that we had a call for service that involved shots fired, that somebody had shot at one of our police officers. When I found the details of what occurred and how they responded and how they reacted, sometimes I think people worry about how much money we spend in the name of training. Well, I will tell you the reason that we didn't lose a police officer that night was training. They did what they were supposed to do. A round went right by one of the officer's heads. The intent was to kill him. He had enough wherewithal to get out of the area. They would have been fully justified in returning fire in the circumstances that occurred. But had they returned fire, they would have placed the public at risk because of the location they were in, very confined area with adjacent rooms with people in it, and buildings that we could have caused more damage and taken an innocent life. And the restraint that was exhibited by those officers was exemplary. And the courage they used to contain that scene and maintain it until the tactical team arrived. And then just the integration between moving people from where they needed to be and just shutting down the area so nobody else was put at jeopardy was really something to watch. And more to the fact that, you know, I started barking commands at the deputy what I wanted done as he called me. I went in to get changed, and as I turned on the radio, without him having told these people, they were already doing it. They already knew what to do. They didn't need us to be barking at them to do it. They knew what to do. And that all goes to the level of training and the seriousness with which these police officers take their job in this community. And then just the support, again, that we receive from the Seacoast Emergency Response Team. This is the second time they've been in this community this year for a similar type of incident. That just the cooperation we get from these other communities is essential to the safety of this town and the other towns in the area. So, again, it's just one of those things looking forward. I'd love to tell you that this mayhem we're experiencing is going to stop. I hope it will at some point, but I think we're in for a rough ride with some of the issues that are occurring because they're not Hampton issues. They're not New Hampshire issues. They're national issues. Again, I was out at the IACP, and one of my academy classmates is the chief in Sacramento, California. Okay, about as far as we can get from here, and same problems. Big city, same problems he's dealing with. It's just a menace. So it's one of those things you just have to find people that are willing to stay the fight. So far we've been doing good, but a little more help might be needed. So
very good. Now, the next item is the New Hampshire Department of Safety Office of Highway Safety. Are these grants?
These are the grants. If you recall, I came in a couple weeks ago to have you initial all those forms.
Yep.
Those are the grants that we were initialing on. There's a sequence of grants that include, they're all out of the Office of Highway Safety. The first one is the STEP grant, which is Sustained Traffic Enforcement Patrol. When we're out there on 101 and doing the speed monitoring, that's what mostly that is. Then DWI, that's self-explanatory. Distracted driving. That's the new one where people on the phones that somebody described, that's where we're really trying to target because that's becoming an ever-increasing danger to motorists with the death rates really starting to creep up on the DWIs, people being on the phones and crossing over that yellow line and hitting somebody. So that's what that's targeted at. Bike and pedestrian, obviously with the number of crosswalks we have in town and the pedestrian issues that we constantly discuss, that is targeted towards both the vehicle and the pedestrian following New Hampshire law as it applies in those areas. And equipment, the $1,142.50, that's a 50-50 matching grant on a new radar for one of our vehicles. So we did a matching on that. So it's a grand total of $49,502.50 that we need approval from the board to accept. We've been approved, and as soon as we get an acceptance from the board, we can actually start utilizing. They have changed some of these grants. The DWI used to be strictly a summertime thing. I can actually start using this during the holiday season. My intention is, if the board accepts this, to begin DWI patrols on the weekends to try to avoid any holiday tragedies.
What was the total number of that?
It was $49,502.50.
I'll make a motion to accept them.
I'll second it.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Okay.
He has two more budgets.
No, that's right. Yes, I shouldn't. I can't forget the repeat
animal
budget.
Control.
Well, that's the repeat budget we like to call it. Not a lot changes with repeat.
Emergency management is the closest one to the current budget.
Well, we'll go with that one first.
Emergency management?
Yeah.
It
huge budget.
Remains at $1,000. Again, the only thing I would say, I know I've said it a number of times, but I want to be consistent. At some point, we really need to take a look at this. The biggest growing issues I'm dealing with comes under that emergency management function. If you look at what New Hampshire Homeland Security Management, they're involved in a lot of the stuff we do. And with emergency management, we have a nuclear power plant in our backyard. We have significant weather issues that we experience down here. And we absorb most of what we do between police and fire on a lot of these issues. And reimbursement. We do get some reimbursement from the state on some of this. But I think at some point we should seriously consider a separate entity for emergency management. I think it warrants it in a community that experiences what we experience. And I think it could be a part-time position at some point. I think there's a lot of talented, skilled people in this town that have experience in this area that would fit the bill at a 28-hour a week position or something along that line somewhere in the future.
I know we have a number of surrounding towns that have this as a separate entity. I know Seabrook does.
Yep. I'll move the $1,000.
Yep. Second.
All right. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Animal control.
Fund we refer to as the repeat budget. Not much has changed. This is Peter McKinnon. Most people know him. He drives around in that nice van with the paws all over it. We get a lot of compliments. We got rid of that the old rust bucket pickup he had been driving for 10 years. Finally gave in, and the van has been a lot more popular with the kids. They always ask about Pete and the little paw van. So 1.01 increase.
That's basically wages, isn't it?
That's wages because of steps, and he's been here a long time. So.
Yeah. Well, now I'll move that budget.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
You don't have any other sub-budgets, Fred? I'm not sure.
No, I think you're
good.
Yep. Unless you're one on Harrison.
No. I'm very happy with what I got.
Stay and get beat up for more stuff. We can keep
No, here. I'm very good. I've kept Christy here long enough.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. All right,
gentlemen.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Why don't we, before we go to the town manager's report, why don't we look at the rest of the budget and what we want to do with that? Might as well have Christy come right up and...
Where would we like to start?
Whoa,
wow. I sent out a memo earlier today and put copies in your mailbox, kind of breaking down all the different sections that we need to have action on. Rick, thank you. You just knocked two of them off my list by passing the emergency management and animal control. So we're down two now from all the ones. So, and then you also received the default budget, I think, on either Thursday or Friday of last week, I believe. And a copy of that was in your mailbox. So we can start at the top or
okay,
wherever you guys feel
there?
Like going through. All right, so the first one that has not been voted on yet would be the town manager's. It's in at $282,511. I don't know if you need to have a discussion on that or where you want to go. So.
Well, let's pull it up.
We'll just go down the list, and you guys can let me know if you want to talk or if we are going to vote or what.
Well, why don't we... that's under the executive, right?
Yes.
Sir.
Yep.
Yep.
Sorry, under executive, yes.
Right. So...
the number may be a little different than what you have in front of you. $282,511. That one has changed since the books were made, but has not changed from what you received on Friday.
282,511.
I so moved that figure for the executive amount.
Do we
have to discuss
wages at this point?
Wages at this point?
No, you don't have to.
You don't have to. I think this is probably the point where we should bring this up.
Okay, so
I would think.
So I'd like to make a motion that we include in the 2017 budget a 2% merit raise. Oh, I'm sorry. To increase the town manager's salary by 6% effective April 1st.
April 1st of 2016. Okay, that's a motion.
So that is a motion.
Second. Any conversation? Jim?
Yeah, I'm against that. I think it should be any wage increases should be included in the budget and give people the opportunity to vote on increases, to look at it. I think there are a lot of wages that need to be increased, but I think it needs to be done in a really transparent manner, and I think people need to be able to voice their opinion on it. So that's my opinion, that it needs to be in the budget for next year. We didn't put it in the budget for this year, and we should have.
Well, I know typically we wait until we have our performance evaluations, and that's not done until usually the latter part of the summer or early fall, so it's hard to put it into the budget if you don't have your evaluations done. So typically that's not been part of the budget. They've done that, but I hear what you're saying.
So any further discussion? Mr. Welch has served remarkably. His evaluations, although not public, done by the board, have been extraordinary. The revenue that he oversees, and of course there's the school split, exceeds $60 million when you include warrants. It's a $70 million corporation. He leads both union and non-union personnel to the tune of perhaps Hampton's largest company. Maybe Foss Manufacturing is more, but certainly none come close to the responsibilities that he leads. He's done an extraordinary job. He's turned this town around from perhaps a morale low 4 or 5 years ago when much news was in the paper, and he's widely responsible for that. He is now at a point with this pay raise where he is not subordinate to department heads, which have received raises this past year, where an employee would be making more than the chief executive. I fully support his extremely proficient tenure and support the pay raise at 6%, and echo Rusty's sentiments that the evaluations are done, and it makes sense to give pay raises for merit in a meritocracy for performance of duty that is so stellar and certainly must be recognized post the publication and the evaluation of that employee. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Anybody else? So we have a motion and second. All those in favor? Those opposed? 3-2. Okay. While we're here, this would be the town. Assistant Town Manager will be under this also.
Yes, I have another motion, Mr. Chairman, that the board vote to increase the Assistant Town Manager's salary by 3% effective April 1st, 2016.
Have a second? Second?
I'm going to voice the same opinion that I think people deserve a raise, and I think we just need to do the raises in a more efficient manner, in a more open and transparent manner, and I think there are a lot of our departments that are the pay scales are wrong. There's discrepancies, and we really need to take a serious look at it and take a serious. And that when we offer this, that the people know what we're doing. So that's my opinion.
And I would just like to say that I agree with Jim 100%. I think they should all be done at the exact time. Everything should be taken into consideration. And it should be put into, it should be included in the budget.
And I agree. I think it should be put in the budget. However, it wasn't for this year, and we've already given out raises to everybody else. So I think we have to address that. Now, whether we address next year's budget of putting some money in there, that might be the thing that we want to do. But this is for addressing this year's part of the budget.
And I just want to stem on what Rusty said. We haven't done it. We didn't do it for this year. But I think what we do. The way I see it is there's a lot of people that deserve raises that maybe haven't gotten them. And we need to start somewhere. And like Mr. Bean said, you can't have department heads making more than our marvelous town manager who oversees this whole operation. So I think you start with the town manager, you work your way down, and over time we'll work it out. And if we think we should maybe add these to the 17 budget, then I think we should probably do that. So this way it's open and everything's in there when it goes for its next review.
Okay. But how many other department heads make more?
Make more than the town manager?
Yes.
None, no.
I know.
No, we've just made it. We've corrected that.
Just the police.
Yeah, just the police. And that's why we went with the police. you know, it was widely different, and that's why we tried to, you know, make it, it's not that I'm against anyone getting these pay raises, but we tried to correct a wrong there, but I think we have to correct the wrongs in a better way than what we're, what's been,
okay,
what is happening.
I'd like to address the issue of transparency. There's been no discussion on my part with any other board member about a pay raise. Other board members can speak to the issue if they'd like to. But when people are talking about transparency, there's been one meeting about this. It was held tonight, if I may say so. And there were discussions. That meeting lasted about 28 minutes. The issues that were discussed will be addressed by motions by Selectman Barnes. They'll be voted on in full transparency for the public tonight. We've been voted on and put into office by the people of this town and to act as selectmen in accordance with the law. But there's been no dodging of any transparency issues. The timing of the process may not meet everybody's approval, but there are men and women doing good work, and they've been evaluated. We wish to retain them. We wish to keep high standards, as we've heard from the police department tonight in their magnificent performance. It's a moving target. It's not perfect, but I support the motion, and there'll be a few more to come, and I'll support those. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Let me just clarify transparency. In no way did I mean that anything was being done behind anybody's back or anything. I should have said the voters have some more to say on it, so they have more to say on the budget. So I should have worded it differently. In no way did I mean to say that anything was being done behind anybody's back.
And I am trying to suggest that, you know, it's maybe our mistake for not including it in the budget.
And I think we all agree with that. It should be at some point in time. But that being said, we need to do something. So we have a motion now for 3% for the assistant town manager. It has been duly seconded. All those in favor? 3. Those opposed? 2.
And then I also have a motion that the assistant town manager be added to the town's life insurance program for full-time employees at no cost to the employee.
Second?
Yes, and the dollar figure that is under...
roughly $180, I believe.
Yeah, it was under $200.
50 cents a day.
Yeah, and that's just something that all of our full-time employees have. And yes, he's less than full-time, but his position, he does not have a lot of benefits, and this is one benefit that we feel that we should allow him to have.
I have no problem.
All those in favor?
I'm just going to abstain because I wasn't at the meeting.
Okay, 4, 1 abstention. Okay, now getting back to the town manager's budget, do you want to put a figure in there of an increase for next year? Is that...
I would make a motion that we put a figure in there for a raise next year.
Okay. What are you looking at a figure? Is this, you can do this now, right? You have the ability.
0.06. It changes a whole bunch of lines in the budget. So I can...
We'll see how good you are.
Once you change any wage line in the budget,
yep,
it affects several other sections of the budget.
Okay.
Line items, so it'll change my numbers a little, but and I will, but it can be done to answer okay. your question.
So, what are you looking at to put in for a?
I would put in 3%.
3% for both.
That's my feeling.
On next year's
budget
on the 2017 budget.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor? Unanimous.
Sorry, Christy.
Okay.
So is
Did you want to put that directly into the town manager section and not into the merit line, correct?
Right.
Okay. All right. So that number is going to change to, let's see. That should be the new one. Let me just change these numbers real quick.
Yep. And again, I think you're right. This at least gives some full transparency. so that doesn't necessarily they're going to mean they're going to get the 3%, right. But at least it has something in there for them.
In there to do it.
So it's 3 for both of them, correct?
Yep.
So he's up to... Okay, so now the new total for the town manager section of the budget is going to be, let's see, it's going to be $288,487 for that section.
$288,487?
Yes.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Okay. Now I'll just continue through my memo and we'll stop when needed. Okay.
Yep,
so the next thing, this was an error that I made. The budget committee, when I had put their budget forward, I did not include the $2,000 that they had added to legal. And so the vote you guys took at a previous meeting was for $3,150 and their budget should be $5,150. So when I was reviewing, I noticed that error. So
they're looking for...
Well, I don't know what they're looking for. I'm just putting forward what was in the 16 budget because they usually make their budget at their level. But you guys voted on what I had put forward from the 16 budget, and I had made an error in what I put forward. So if you want to vote on the $5,150, that would be what the amount that was in the 2016 budget for the budget committee.
Make a motion, we do.
I'll second it.
Somebody make a motion to add...
Is adding $2,000.
$2,000 to the budget committee, so it will be...
Which is the same exact thing as 2016. It was just me that they hadn't had that line, and they added it last year, so on my new spreadsheet, it didn't have it included, so I missed it.
So legal will be the $2,000.
Yep.
And the new line, bottom line on the budget will be $5,150.
Yep.
We have a motion on the budget committee's...
I make motion.
Motion. Seconded. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Okay.
We already did the selectmen's one, correct?
Yep.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm just going in order on all the ones
all right.
that weren't voted
on. I just want to make sure we hit everything. That's
yep,
all.
I hopefully did my spreadsheet right. I double-checked it. So the next one was the finance department last week when I was here. Or I don't even know which week it was anymore. But the last time I was here, I had proposed to you that I needed to adjust my budget to cover some FMLA leave that I'm going to have in my department next year. I had given you guys a spreadsheet for you to review. So the finance department budget is now, I'm requesting $383,411. And that was just a change in the regular wage line and the part-time wage line.
So regular wage line will now be?
The regular wage line is now, let's see here. The regular wages is now $216,865, and the part-time wage line is $27,794.
Any other questions on the finance? Do we have a motion for finance of
383,411.
Correct. I'll move that.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Audit services, we just didn't vote on that yet. That amount that nothing's changed there, it's $31,650. That's a 3-year contract that we entered into with them last year, I believe. So we're on beyond year 2 of that contract.
I'll move that.
Second it.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
All right, the next one that we have is the assessing department. This is one of the departments where the requested amount is different than the admin amount, and it was in relationship to pay increases that the assessor had put in, 5% for himself and 10% for his other full-time and 10% for his part-time employee. The town manager removed the increase, the administration removed the increases and left them at their wages, what it would be with the 2% that they received this year. And we also increased the merit line. On the merit line for next year, I think they proposed 2% raises for all non-union, and they included a 6% raise for the full-time position in the assessing department. So the budget in front of you is for $287,501. That shouldn't be any different than what you guys had, but.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to make a motion on this, that the board vote for a 6% increase for the assistant assessor 2017 budget.
In the 2017 budget?
Yes.
Yeah, let's just address this. Well,
was there a second first?
Just address this. This is another one of those situations where the assessor has asked for the 5% increase, where we have a discrepancy in what he's being paid now. Whereas at one time the office was six people in there.
Mm-hmm.
It's now then it was four people. It's now three people. We've just gone through reeval and stuff. He's done a lot of work on it. I think that the assistant, the raise should be in there. But I think this is another one that we really have to look at for next year. It overall, with all the salaries that we have and what we're going to do and how we're going to adjust things. Because, you know, if you're going from a six-person office to a three-person office and the town's growing and you're doing more and more work, it doesn't make sense.
Somebody's obviously doing more and more work.
Yeah, somebody's obviously doing more and more work. And I'm not saying we should be giving money away or giving raises away or anything, but we should take a good look at it and see where we're going with all of this.
So we have a motion on the floor to add a 6% for the assistant.
And that is already included in the merit line.
We
can move it to the assessing department if you want, but we did include a 6% increase for the assessing assistant in the merit line.
Right. So.
Okay, so that's already there.
Someplace else.
That's right. Yeah, just someplace
okay,
else.
Okay.
All right. Okay.
All right. Very good.
Good with that.
So if you were to vote on the $287,501, that would leave everyone at their current salaries, but then they on the merit line you do have 2% in there for the assessor, and you have 2%. You would have 2% in there for the part-time clerk who works the window there, and then you'd have 6% in there for the assessing assistants. So all three of them would be included in the merit line with the non-union raises at those amounts.
Is that how you prefer?
It makes no difference to me. I'm just telling you how it is right now. Because we put the merit line in a few years ago, and so that's what's on the merit line now.
And how does that look going forward? Is it better to just make the change now, move it from merit into the department to assign true costs, or how do you prefer it as an accounting professional?
It makes no difference to me. So
okay.
I think it's however you guys prefer. I know a while ago that was something that the board had chosen to do, to move it all out to the merit line. And then it gave them some flexibility on how it was distributed, I think, is how that all began.
But it's in the merit
line. It is in the merit line for sure, yeah. I'll grab my spreadsheet just to verify, but I know we did put it in there.
We did move it over.
Okay. And what is that?
Yeah. It's under personnel.
Okay.
That's where she just went to get her personnel.
I just went to get all my backup here. So, but yeah, it should be. It is in the merit line under the personnel. Yeah, so it's exactly what I had said. It would be 2% for the assessor, 2% for the individual who is the part-time clerk at the window, and then 2% for the full-time, or 6%, I'm sorry, for the full-time assessing assistant is on the merit line.
Okay.
Thank you.
And take away the motion.
Take away the motion.
Very good. So we need a motion now to accept the $287,501?
Yes.
I'll make that motion.
Motion by Rick, seconded by Jim. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Okay, the tax collector's all set. Legal is all set. Personnel administration, I'm going to skip over in case any other changes are made when we go through, because we thought to do fire, police, and all those big departments. So we'll come back to that one.
Okay.
Planning board is all set. Zoning board, I do this every year. We took a vote last week to approve the whole section there, so we voted on $155,979 for zoning, but it really should only be $5,810. I made the same mistake last year because it's right underneath zoning.
So for a motion to correct.
Yeah, so the zoning budget you want to put forward is only 5,810, not 155,000.
I make that motion.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Okay, town buildings, cemeteries done. Municipal insurance, we'll skip that one also till the end. I don't think it should change, but just in case. Parking administration is good. We have the big departments now, or we can, if you want, I can skip down to all the small ones. We have to do them all, I think, if that's...
Yeah, we got to do them all, guys, so might as well go right through.
All right, so the police department would be next. He was just here. His budget is put forward at $4,107,300.
I move that motion. My mom.
I'll second it.
Motion seconded. All those in favor? Unanimous.
I have trick-or-treat candy if anyone needs a little pick-me-up to get it through.
Sugar high.
Okay, and then the next one is the fire department. When he was here, his budget was $3,549,446. So that's what was put forward by administration. I don't know.
Any questions on the fire budget?
You had asked for figures, Mr. Chairman, on certain things.
Is that the traffic signals?
Traffic signals.
Well, that's in another section.
That's in highway, isn't it?
No, it's not on highway anymore. It's under other safety services.
Under other safety services, so it's not under this one's
right.
Okay. So
I have we taken out the ice rescue sled? Was that never in there, or was it taken out before?
I believe that that was under new equipment and was reduced by administration.
Okay.
I think.
Yeah. All right.
Right, Fred, or no?
Yes, and we've ordered him to buy it.
Right.
This year.
Okay, that's good.
So don't put it back in because we've already...
Yep.
It was taken out, right, Fred? I'm trying to
I believe
find
it was
right
taken
now,
out.
I'm pretty sure it was.
I'm just... The other one was... Fred, was under training or something that did the administration reduce...
Yes, training and under the training section, and recruitment, the he had requested $68,531, and administration had put forward $35,503.
Okay. I would just like an explanation on that. I mean, I think training is, as we just said, the police chief just sat in here and explained that they avoided some real serious situations this year because of appropriate training for their personnel. So I'm just wondering if we're taking money out of training, why we're taking money out of training.
The town voted last year to allow the fire department to do special training, and the chief has decided that he needs to have that $70,000 every year forever. We asked for justification, and there wasn't justification provided. And now the facility is burned down that they were using, so they can't do it anyhow. So they're looking for additional resources in order to get that training done so they can finish the training the town meeting authorized them to do.
Okay.
But we didn't think it was a good proposition just because it was approved one time in the history of the fire department to repeat it every single year.
Okay.
Yeah, we did suggest that it be staggered over maybe a four-year period, one shift per year or something. So we did put money in there for some of that.
Any other questions on the fire department budget? Seeing none, motion to
$3,549,446.
$3,549,446.
I'll move that.
Second it.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Okay, the next,
building.
The building department had some changes in there, one wage-related. I'm under the impression there's one wage-related change in there. And then I also, at the end of September, we reevaluated all of our gasoline and diesel lines. I know, Rusty, you had asked about that when the chief was up here. All the department heads put forward what they believe their use was. Fred has tasked myself, I guess, with verifying all of those numbers, and we have taken it upon ourselves to adjust those numbers accordingly so that we are really fine-tuning those accounts and only asking for what is actually being
expended on those line items, and we're basing it all on gallons. So I had adjusted the building department gasoline line to be more in line with what they were actually purchasing for gasoline.
And Mr. Chairman, I have something.
Yep.
I'd like to make a motion that the board approve a 5% salary adjustment to the building inspector's salary effective November 1st, 2016.
I would like to just voice my opinion in opposition to that, simply because I want to, in the budget, if we're going to do any salary adjustments, I think they should be in the budget for next year, and I think it should be discussed in that manner. And not that I don't think there needs to be an adjustment, but again, it's the same thing as before. We're just making adjustments here. Just
well, I know we're making adjustments, but I also know that we've done some. We've asked that the assistant town manager do some research on what our pays are and how they are, and I think we all realize that this position is severely below what it should be. So
I totally agree with what Jim has said, and I totally agree also that he's totally underpaid. He does one of the best jobs that you could expect from a department head, but I do think it should be included in the budget.
Yeah, we've reviewed Mr. Schultz's budget. We know that his department costs the town virtually nothing in terms of the revenue base. Is that correct?
Oh, yes.
And
I think this year he's already taken in more revenue than his total budget for next year.
If the selectmen have not kept pace with their administrative requisites to administrate pay issues in this town, an employee should not have to wait for 6 months when if you do a little research and get a grasp of the operational intensity and the complexity and the $500 million that have been added in appreciating property values that all had to be coded from incredibly complex new construction in this town to include the brewery on the west side, the myriad development projects at the beach, and nothing so short as code enforcement on Foss Manufacturing. The selectmen have all received a New Hampshire state report and inspection on that. Go try and figure that out and do the code enforcement at Foss Manufacturing. And I'll buy you lunch if you can decipher that. So it's an incredibly, incredibly complex, important job that is significantly underpaid. And kudos to the man that runs that, Mr. Welch. And he's been, Mr. Schultz, how long has he been with us?
About 18 years.
Almost 20 years, yeah.
Almost 20 years. Yeah. So I enthusiastically support the motion by Selectman Barnes.
I agree with everything that was said, but I also agree that there are other departments that have done the same thing, that we could say the same thing. We've had a number of mediated settlements with on tax abatements and stuff. We've had, you know, increased valuation of property on that. So I agree 100% with what we're saying, but I'm saying we've got to take a look at the whole picture and figure this out and do it properly. That's my opinion.
And that's something that I've pushed for ever since the beginning of the year. And evidently we just haven't achieved what needed to be done.
So we have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Those opposed? 32.
So the building department budget bottom line is $225,336.
Would that?
Yes.
Change? Would that change?
Yep.
So we have a motion on the building department budget. So 2253 36.
So moved.
Second.
Oh, all
does
in
that
favor?
Include?
That includes the.
Yes.
The change.
Okay.
That was
yeah. Those opposed? 3-2.
All right. Emergency management, we already took care of. Hydrants is done. Streetlights and repairs. Now we're on to the one that Fred had mentioned that he had he had provided some numbers in regards to
emergency management. No.
Nope. Emergency nope. Management was $1,000. You voted on
street
that one.
Lighting.
Rich was here.
Okay. So we had asked back about some of the street lighting and some of the traffic signals.
Right.
The fire department came back with a budget of replacing the three existing. We have one done. We did the center of town, Hampton, with the new photo sensor.
Right.
They came back with the other three lights at
$18,510 per installation.
Per installation.
Which is $55,530 for the total. I wouldn't suggest putting $55,000 there 1 year.
No.
My suggestion is that you do one this coming year and then perhaps two the following year.
I think that's a good idea. And also, we have a price to change the remaining light. There are two types of bulbs in a traffic signal. There are LED lights and there are incandescent lights.
Right.
About a third of the ones that are there are the LEDs and the rest of them are still incandescent. Yeah. The incandescent bulbs don't last as long, and the energy savings is about, if we changed all of them over,
almost 4 to 1,
would be about $4,400 a year savings. So it would cost us about
14,700 with changing the pedestrian signal upgrades.
Right, and the pedestrian signal upgrades right now, they don't meet the MUCTD, which is the
Metco standard. No,
which is the standard for traffic signals.
Correct.
And so that would change those bulbs to do that. So, I would suggest that we increase the traffic signal to 18,510.
By 18,510.
And 14,700
for the other. On top of what's already there.
Yes, additional. And that would give us, like I say, the 14,700, that'll pay for itself in 3 years.
Yeah.
And then those lights, some of those LEDs have been up there for 10 years or better. So,
yeah. I make that motion that we increase by 18,510 and 14,700. Is
correct.
Both in the same
that's
motion?
Correct. Yep.
All right. I make
so
that
is that
motion.
All in the same, on the street light repair line?
Yes.
Okay. So let me get those numbers in here real quick. Hold
traffic light repairs.
Yes, traffic light. Sorry, not street light. So we're going to add.
Same thing.
14,700?
Correct.
Yep.
And 18 what?
510.
Okay. Sorry. I just wanted to get that in
there. That will save us from digging those streets up and replacing those wire loops in them every few years.
Which they have done. Every one of those is, and as they get older and the pavement gets worn, those trips in the ground have to get repaired two or three times a year at a cost of $2,000 to $3,000 each time they come in. Yeah.
And it's the one in the middle of town, right, that has the canal.
Yes.
And that is that. If you sit there, it works really well because if there's nobody in the turn lane, it doesn't go to the turn.
Right.
So it really does a much more efficient job.
Absolutely. So, what was the total of that?
37,210, and then we had 220,018 for the electric part of that. So for that whole section for street lighting, it would be $257,228.
I move that amount.
I'll second it.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Okay.
Lifeguards.
All right. Lifeguards, yes. The budget that is in front of you is for $22,160.
I think we leave it in there.
I would like to. I would make a motion to leave it in there.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Then we get down.
To done hydrants already?
Yep.
Yes, okay. Sir.
We did hydrants last one time. Public Works. The grand total for the whole Public Works Department is $5,189,072. It's made up of the highways and streets at $2,006,211 and municipal sanitation at $3,182,862.
So moved.
Second it.
Just one question. this is one department we've talked about for a couple of years now about adding people.
Be a warrant article.
Be a warrant article?
Yes.
Okay.
And I believe they've already submitted a warrant article for the board to consider as time goes on.
Because we see the more and more trash we're picking up, the more and more stuff. The highway department is actually, on many good days, is down to one person, and it's just not effective. So hopefully that we do see a warrant article with that. So we have a motion and a second at
$5,189,072.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Okay. Recreation and parks. The administration budget in front of you is for $234,270. It's lower than the requested amount. The library director, where's recreation on here? She had put in wage increases for her two part-time parks maintenance employees that were removed at the administration level.
Now those, I'll wait.
Go ahead.
Those two employees, did they get the merit raises?
Yes, they did.
Yes, they did.
And they're included in the merit raises for next year also. At the same level that all other, at the 2%, I'm sorry. And they did receive the merit increases when the non-union received the merit increases this year too. Which I believe was 2% this year.
Correct.
Yes.
Well, I like Jim has suggested, I think we need to come up with a committee to look at and address wages in this town, especially for our non-contractual employees. These two gentlemen have been there a long period of time, and I think they should have at least be making what the highway department workers make as laborers and stuff like that. They've been there a long time. These are, how long have we had these two employees?
Oh, a long time. I can't tell you how many years, but it's been significant.
And they've been, they're continually tasked with doing more and more and more and more and more and with less and less. Just like all our employees are. All our employees are continually tasked with doing more. So I think we really need to take a look at this and see if we can find some sort of common ground at making these raises. So, any other questions, concerns, statements, or none being, we need a motion to Parks and Recs.
I make the motion.
At total for Parks and Recs is
$234,270 is the amount brought forward by administration.
$234,270. I have a motion. Is there a second?
Got it.
Any questions?
I mean, we have them in the line for the 2% merit, right?
Yes.
Yes.
I mean, they take care of the total parks, right?
Yep,
that's correct. That's their job. Now, obviously, some of it's contracted out for mowing and things of that nature.
Yeah.
But all the maintenance and everything else they do.
I mean, if we're going to talk about adjusting their salary next year, we really should put something in the budget for that.
Mm-hmm.
That's what.
Yep.
So I would, we already have a motion. Can I make an amendment?
You can make an amendment.
So let's rescind the motion. Start over.
I rescind the motion.
All right. I make a motion that we, you know, add 2% to this budget for those two positions.
An additional 2%.
Yeah. Yeah, to look at, to see if that's, just so we have something in there.
Mm-hmm.
You figure that one out?
You can't make it simple.
Am I still going to get candy in your office, or am I going to be kicked out?
You might want to take what's on the table before you leave. So you would like to leave them on the merit line for 2%, but you would like to also increase their...
Include 2% in
the recreation budget also?
That they can look at. Does not necessarily mean they're going to get it. You see what I'm saying?
But it's there in case you want
to. It's there in case we want
to. Very so you clear. Don't want to adjust it to what she has proposed. You would like to just adjust it by 2%?
Yes.
Okay. All right, so that was the last, besides personal administration.
Get a vote on it, so.
I know, but how about, I was going to make a proposal for you guys so that okay. we can make sure we have good votes here. How about you guys, maybe you guys can move on and go to the town manager's report and then come back to me so I have some time to
okay.
put all those numbers in and then we can rediscuss together. It.
That good idea.
It'll be
excellent.
Better numbers, hopefully.
We'll go to the town manager's report and then come back to this.
Okay.
All right. I would love a doctor.
Oh, look, he gets and the candy.
I have,
he's smart.
I have a few things, Mr. Chairman, so it's going to take a few minutes.
That's good. She
That's
probably
good. Take
needs
some
it.
Time, Fred.
she needs it. Stall.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, okay. That was the stall cue. Mr. Chairman, members of the board, citizens should be aware that town ordinance prohibits the overnight parking on all streets within the town of Hampton from 1 a.m. to 7 a.m. from November 15th through the following March 15th. We're getting close to the 15th, so I'm bringing it up so people will be aware of the fact. I'll bring it up at our next couple of meetings as well. Zoning petition articles may be accepted between November 14th and December 14th. Articles petitioned for the annual town meeting, except for zoning, may be accepted until January 10th, 2017. If you are among those folks who have still not paid for the licensing for your dog, please do so with the town clerk's office as soon as possible. That will allow us to stop your penalties and fines. I could tell you just as a sort of a hint, we had some folks come in late in the year to pay their fines, and in a couple of cases, they paid well over $100 to license a dog that would have been licensed for $7 in the spring. So the state statute puts these myriad escalating fines on that we have no control over. So we kind of would like people to come in and pay those, get them done, and we'd like you to please license your dog in the spring when it comes due so that you don't have to be faced with these unusual requests to pay huge fines or to go to court. And we don't want to see you go to court either. Mr. Chairman, I did have a request this afternoon to let people know that there will be a local energy solutions conference on November 19th, 2016, from 8:30 a.m. to 4 p.m. at the Grohoney Center in Concord. Everybody's invited. Come on down and take a look at energy efficiencies. Hampton Beach State Park Fall Community Meeting, which is what Rick was talking about a little earlier, will be on Monday, December 7th. It's going to be run down at the parks facility at the beach, which is in a seashell complex. It will be from 5 to 6:30 p.m. State staff will be there to answer questions, try to tell you what the program is going to be for next year. Please drop in and say hi, listen to what's going on, and maybe you'll have something to participate in the following year because they'll give you some good ideas, or you might give them some good ideas. Rooms and meals. I did want to make note that in setting the tax rate, the finance department has informed me that for some strange reason, even though they're supposed to be frozen, the state gave us $56,000 extra in rooms and meals reimbursements, which I think was very nice. Leaf collection update. The collection began on Monday, May 7th, and will be completed on Friday. Monday, November 7th, and will be completed on Friday, November 11th. However, all of the things in life going on, keep an eye on the website because we have had some breakdowns of equipment and that may be postponed for a week. We're going to continue collecting leaves as we go through the fall and into the early winter, just so that we don't have extensive catch basin problems. I do have a request which came in from Unitel. We've been holding it now for about 2 weeks because it wasn't completed properly. This is to install poles.
They're trying to serve with permanent installation of poles, the new facilities up on Drake Side Road, and they need a permit from the Board of Selectmen to do that. All of their paperwork is in proper order and needs to be signed by the board. There are three separate items to be signed. Both Unitel and telephone company have, in fact, petitioned jointly, which is required by law, and they are ready for signature. And I'm going to hold that out so that we can act on that, I hope, tonight, so they can get that work done before the winter sets in. The Army Corps of Engineers has completed the work in the harbor of rebuilding the barriers coming in. It took quite a bit of effort on their part. They were there for several weeks. The breakwater has been finished. And now we have received a request from Gino Marconi on behalf of the harbor. He is the harbor master for the Port Authority. There is a question regarding from the New Hampshire delegation about helping the Army Corps obtain some funds for dredging Seabrook and Hampton Harbor again. It silted in so quickly after the last dredge. And the question is, would the board like to participate in that? And if you authorize me to, I'll be happy to send the authorization on to the Army Corps and ask them to, doesn't cost us anything, but ask them to come in and please clean the harbor again so that traffic can go in and out effectively. So that's two things to hold. Follow up on Monday's Board of Selectmen meeting. I talked to Bill Watson, and we're going to try to get a meeting together on the 14th at 9 a.m. just to sit and begin the process of talking about what they're planning to do on Route 1A. I've invited Public Works, I've invited Town Council to sit, to listen to what Bill has to say and what the state is offering. And I'll be happy to bring a report back to the board so that we know what's going on. And I believe, I hope, that's it.
Any questions for the town manager? Rick?
I have a question about that. Sure. It's a Monday morning.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. I would be able to be there, because I am on the Hampton Area Commission.
Yeah. Come on now. I think John Lyon's coming, too.
Yeah. I did talk with Bill Watson at the meeting, and he mentioned about that would be happening.
Bill's finally back to work, and, he had an episode this year, and so.
Yeah, his wife passed on.
Yes.
So do we need a motion for...
For the Unitel license, for the telephone pole license, yes, sir, we do. What about the other one? I really think you need a motion if you want to participate, getting the Army Corps of Engineers to provide the funding to dredge the harbor. And they say it needs to be done again, so.
I'll make both those motions.
Let's do one at a time. The first motion will be for the Unitel on
the... I'll move that.
The joint poles.
I'll second it.
Where are these poles going?
Drake Side Road.
Look at the plan. They're going Pole Farm Road between
Pole Farm Road,
Drake Side Road and the 101,
right,
or the brewery.
Okay. All right.
They bring that power line down to serve those new buildings.
Okay.
What it does is just complete, it would give them a loop circuit instead of having a dead end. So we have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Unanimous.
I'll make that second motion.
Second motion is to deal with
dredging
of the Hampton Harbor.
Right. I'll second that.
And I just have to say that, we don't have as much industry as we used to have coming out of Hampton Harbor, but we still have a lot of boat traffic, we still have some fishermen that still work, a lot of them out of the Seabrook side, but quite a few of them still out of the Hampton side. Both lobstermen and fishermen and in the party boats. And we had a boat up on the rocks there two meetings ago while we were here, when they had the king tide. And part of that's because of the way the harbor is. So I think we do need that dredge. So.
And this is at no cost.
This is at no cost to us, correct.
Yeah.
So the motion is seconded. All those in favor? Unanimous.
That's now, just so everybody knows, that's now a federal waterway. the state has released its jurisdiction over the harbor, and the Army Corps of Engineers has jurisdiction there except for moorings.
Any other questions for the town manager? Jenna? Phil? Rick?
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you. Next one is new business, or old business.
Old business.
New business, old business, correct.
Our real estate salesman is ready.
Yes, good evening.
Good evening.
This 27 Pearl Street deeding that appears on the agenda under old business relates to the tax-deeded property that was auctioned at public auction on January 29th, 2016, the day before the deliberative session. This generated quite a bit of interest. As a matter of fact, there appeared to be more attendees there than there were at the deliberative session the next day. And a very acceptable bid came in, far in excess of the amount that ultimately is owed to the town by way of taxes, interest, penalties, and other items allowed by law. And so the reason that it's taken this long to get to this point is that there were some issues with the title that the buyer at the sale wished to get resolved, and which appear to have been resolved. And so we are anticipating a closing this week. I'd like to see that tomorrow. We have a proration that has been done of the taxes using the tax rate that we've just gotten and the new assessed value for 2016, so as to be able to get an accurate figure. And we have a deed that is now in front of the board, and recommend that the board sign this particular deed. And the second item is the HUD statement reflecting all the figures that has been generated by the buyer's closing agent, and accurately reflects what needs to be done at the closing and the amounts that would come to the town, and recommend that the selectman authorized the town manager to sign that document.
Make that motion.
There's two motions there, correct?
Sure. The first is to sign the deed.
First motion to sign the deed. Seconded by?
I'll second it.
All's in favor? Unanimous.
The second is
motion is to the HUD statement.
Authorize the town manager to sign the HUD statement as
make
presented.
Motion to authorize the town manager to sign the HUD statement.
Seconded by Regina. Oh, Rick, you have all's in favor. Unanimous.
Thank you.
Okay. New business. Clarification of snow emergency parking 805-9C. Daily rental parking lots.
Did she give you a report on that?
I don't know.
I don't know either. I have one. I know.
All right, you want to?
We're preparing for the wintertime onslaught of parking, and I put a notice, as you heard me earlier, say that parking on street parking is not allowed at certain times on the beach. What happened was that when they published the code, they added in a little something. Except during the hours of 1 p.m. to 7 a.m., between the dates of November 15th and March 15th the following year, including any hours that are not a declared snow emergency for parking vans. Those words never appeared in the ordinance that was adopted by the selectmen. We've gone back and researched that, and we would like you to vote to take the words out that don't belong there so that we can have the code properly fixed. They just don't belong there. You never voted them. And how they got in there, we don't know. But that's the way they came back published.
Do
they transposed it from someplace else, we don't know.
So it's basically just taking out... Thank you.
The words that are crossed out there. Oh, thank you.
Taking out the... Except during the hours of... Can't read it because it's crossed out.
Yeah.
It's taking out that exception, with the exception of Veterans World War II Park, Ashworth Ave, and the Veterans World War I Park, Island Path Municipal Park, lots for off-street parking of personal vehicles shall be allowed during these any set hours that are declared snow emergencies. The vehicles must be removed by 7 a.m. for Section C. So it's to allow people to park in there on snow emergencies.
For certain days, yeah.
Certain days. Okay. So I have a motion to accept that the change. Second. All those in favor?
Just wacko.
Unanimous.
Thank you.
While we're talking on parking.
Yes.
The town parking lot, I've noticed there's still a boat trailer up there, uptown.
Uptown?
Yes. It's been there for quite a while.
I sure.
And if we could ask Public Works to do a little maintenance around the outside edge, especially up on the High Street edge, the brush has grown up
quite high
on the pole.
Okay.
Right there on the corner lot between there and the medical building.
Will do.
So.
Will do. We'll also go through, because every year we have to go through the parking lot to determine whether or not there are vehicles there that are not, in fact, licensed or registered and do not have parking permits. And there is an area where they're allowed to park all year long. And we periodically find cars in there with flat tires that have been there for a long time and aren't registered. So.
I don't mind people parking, but if you're leaving a boat trailer there for an extended period of time, that's not what the town of parking lot is intended.
In fact, it's a violation of the ordinance.
That's right. So.
So we'll check all that.
Any other old business? Don't believe. New business? We're already on that. So.
Just got to go back to Christy.
Oh, we have one on here, the lawn maintenance.
Yes.
Sorry about that.
Yep.
Lawn maintenance 2016-016 bid waiver for purchase policy pricing procedures.
We bid this out. There were 10 companies that were solicited. Two responded. Actually, a third one responded but came in a day late, so we couldn't open that bid. The recommendation is, one, to waive the bidding policy for less than three bidders, and two, to award it to the low bidder. The low bidder was $33,151 for each year for 3 years. And that was Lubdell Landscaping Company of Northampton.
And we get, like you said, we put it out to 10 bidders, only got two. A third one came in, but
came in late,
a dollar short.
Yeah.
So... I need a motion to waive the bid purchasing policy and award that contract to...
I would make that motion.
Motion seconded?
Seconded.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Now we'll go back to Christy.
Okay. Back to me. So the personnel administration section, which has your retirement and all your taxes and stuff... The amount will be $3,179,510.
What was that again?
$3,179,510.
That's one of the changes that we made?
Yep.
So I need a motion and a second to accept that.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Okay, and the other section we didn't vote on that wasn't changed from anything we did tonight is municipal insurance. I will just point out in there, since I think we've talked about it publicly, but the health insurance rates went up 6.7%. We also did receive workers' comp and property liability. We don't have it in writing yet, but they're going up 3.3% and 3.4%. I think the workers' comp was the 3.3 and the property liability was the 3.4. Well, my memory served me right. So those went up. So the municipal insurance will be $3,838,501.
And do you want to do each one of the lines, or you have that already?
I can read all the lines to you.
I'm just so that people are clear where that came from.
Yeah, I can tell you right now because we haven't discussed it. So Health property liability is $356,151. Like I said, that went up 3.4%. Medical insurance is at $2,965,099. That's up 6.7%. Life insurance is at $19,706. Unemployment is at $3,000. Workers' compensation, $477,518. And NHMA dues at $17,027. So that comes up to the $3,838,501.
Any discussion? Is there a motion?
I'll make a motion.
Second. Make a motion, seconded by Regina. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Okay, and then for the Parks and Rec Department, so with adding the 2% increase, so it brought one of the part-timers from $12.58 to $12.83 an hour, and the other part-timer from $15.73 to $16.04. And let me get back down to that section. So the Recreation Department budget now will be $235,610. Let's just see if that.
Any questions on the Parks and Recs? Is there a motion?
I'll make a motion.
Motion by Regina, seconded by Phil. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Okay. So now, just to summarize up for you, the total budget is $26,894,639, which puts it $253,868 above the 16 budget and $364,197 less than the default budget.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous.
Okay. And you have the default budget in front of you. The amount of the default budget is $26,489,103.
So that was also what we just did, too?
The default budget, we did not review line by line or section by section. We do not usually go through it. We can go through each department if you would like.
Does it have a change in it, though?
It's included in there.
That's yep. What I meant.
Oh, I'm sorry. Yes. Those changes were, yeah.
She's updated it.
Okay.
Yeah, so it should be $26,489,103.
Motion to accept the default budget.
Motion to accept it.
Seconded by Phil. All those in favor? Unanimous.
One more quick thing. Fred, you'll have to help me out here. Do they need to approve the revenue budget that's going to go in the budget books or not?
Not legally, no. Nobody needs to approve the revenue budget because it's not final until DRA sets it in September.
Okay. And I just want to make sure we covered everything so that we can get the budget books. I believe that it's the board's goal now. We can print the budget books and get them off to the budget committee as quickly as humanly possible.
Possible, and also when it's ready, we'll be able to put it on the website.
On the website, yeah.
Okay.
Now, you said it again, and you went right through it real quick. How much less is this year's budget over the default?
It's not. This year's the 17 budget is more than the
more
default.
More than the default by?
Yeah, by $364,197. But it's only $253,868 over the 16 budget that was passed.
Okay. Very good.
Okay.
Thank you for all your hard work.
Yes, thank you.
No, you've been very
busy. Thanks, Director.
Yep. Yes, she has.
Nice job.
Thanks.
Good job.
Exceptionally busy.
Okay, any closing comments?
Motion to adjourn. Chairman, if the board... I'm sorry.
Pardon me.
The board can entertain a motion to go into a non-public session under RSA 91A, :3, Roman 2, small c and small e, reputation and litigation. I'd appreciate that.
Motion by?
So moved.
Second.
Seconded by Regina. I need a roll call vote.
Yes, please.
Aye. Jim?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Unanimous.
I'm welcome.
Okay. We're going to a non-public.